If you would ask the average person in any authoritarian state, such as Sweden or China, if they support people to freely speak what is on their mind, they would most likely respond in a positive way. Once they would hear anyone say anything that they would disagree with, they would immediately be in favor of censorship. They would downplay and label what they don't like to hear as hate speech, conspiracy theory, bigotry, and so on. They have zero tolerance for critical thinking. They have been trained by the government like dogs are trained to obey humans. Doggy sit, humani kiss ass. Critical thinking is considered by them to be crazy. It's far right or extreme right wing. Denying people a human right such as freedom of speech is not considered extreme by them. They are the so-called left, the humanists of hope and love. While the right wing supports nationalism, they support globalism, aka internationalism. The Oxford Dictionary defines globalism as the operation or planning of economic and foreign policy on a global basis. The left wants to remove national borders, like they have done in case of the European Union, the EU. They support big government. The more power the government has over them and everybody else, the better for them. That's what they want. They want the government to be in charge of the healthcare system, education system, press, you name it. At the same time, they claim that the existence of a plan to create a one-world government is a crazy conspiracy theory invented by anti-government right-wing extremists. That's what the so-called Anti-Defamation League, or ADL, says on the website about the term New World Order, which this Talmudist organization has categorized under extremism, terrorism, and bigotry. The New World Order is about planning, creating, and running a one-world government, which is also known as a cosmocracy. Rulers in the past have constantly tried to achieve global dominance. Movies are constantly made where someone is trying to take over the world. It's something that has always been considered, just like the idea of becoming a god. It's all about attaining as much power as possible over people and resources. Throughout history, humans have tried to create political entities that control a piece of land, such as city-states, kingdoms, empires, and so on. Each time technological progress was made, some political entity managed to eventually conquer even more land, but nobody so far has managed to conquer the whole world. The Mongols established the largest contiguous land empire in history. They controlled about 16% of the world's landmass at one point. The Brits controlled about 23% of the world's landmass at one point, spanning all inhabited continents, making the British Empire the largest empire in history. The vast majority of the world remained uncontrolled by the Brits. Europeans collectively controlled about 35% of the world's landmass in 1800. Thanks to the Industrial Revolution, that number changed to about 84% when the First World War began. That was the exterior problem imperialists had. Each empire had the problem that other empires existed. No empire wanted to give up what they had so that another empire could rule over the world. In addition, the idea that the whole world would want to become subjected to one nation was also not working out. People like to segregate themselves by culture, ethnicity, religion, and other differences. It's natural segregation. It's survivalism. You need to be part of a group to withstand being wiped out by another group. The group that has the most in common with you is the group you belong to, so you generally don't want any other group bossing your group around. So it's unsurprising that the French got kicked out of Vietnam, for example. The Turks got kicked out of the Balkans. The Brits got kicked out of India, and so on. There were also several interior problems that the imperialists had, two in particular. The first problem was the natural move towards free market economics. Governments heavily regulated the economy. There was no free market economy, but that began to change. Industrialization required significant work and investment from individuals and not necessarily the government. The second problem was that the church was losing their grip on people. The church was working together with European monarchs. They were brainwashing and fooling people into believing that they were representatives of God, so questioning them was out of the question. But that's what people began to do as more and more people began to see right through them, thanks to the Renaissance, Reformation, and Enlightenment. So the church, which is now called the Catholic Church, got split up in the West. People grew tired of these religious exploiters. Imperialism had to be reformed in order to survive. Various thinkers tried to come up with all kinds of solutions and plans to achieve that. Professor Adam Weishaupt from Germany is the most well-known of those thinkers, followed by philosopher and Talmudist Karl Marx. What emerged from them is international socialism, which is where leftism, as it is known today, is derived from. International socialism blames free market economics for all the problems workers had and didn't have. The offered solution was to essentially make the government the employer and run everything, while claiming that the government doesn't exist and that it's really the collective of workers instead. Their focus was never to actually improve any conditions of the working class, but to make them switch from their exploiting overlords. Instead of private exploiters, the idea was to switch to governmental exploiters. Workers worked and lived in poor conditions back then. They worked 12 to 16 hours per day. A work week was 6 days long. There were no worker rights, no vacation. In the industrial cities and towns of the UK, workers lived in cheap and small apartments that had no running water, sanitation, windows, ventilation, and so forth. Poor hygiene meant diseases, which made everything even worse. About 25% of all children under the age of 5 died of disease and malnutrition. Speaking of children, there was also child labor, so it was easy to sell any propaganda against the private exploiters. Private exploitation was and still is called capitalism, and equalized by international socialists with free market economics. It was set up as their economic archenemy. Nationalism was set up as their political archenemy. Communism is the form of international socialism that was invented by Karl Marx. The communist idea was to make the working class the batteries of international socialism. Instead of empires trying to conquer the whole world, the working class was supposed to be the driving force to merge all empires, kingdoms, and other entities that ruled anything. That meant that nationalism had to be replaced with globalism. When you manage to establish a one-world government, there is essentially only one nation, and therefore globalism becomes the new nationalism. The royal family that was put in charge of a country was seen as the symbol of nationalism. They were seen as the nation's principal family, put in charge by God to rule over the nation. Both the church and the monarchy had to be eradicated, or at least stripped of any power. Unsurprisingly, communism rejects God and promotes atheism. According to history books, the First World War broke out coincidentally, and coincidentally drove the world towards these goals. It was a global war of empires. 4 European empires were destroyed in the war, including the Russian Empire, which became the Soviet Union, the world's first communist state. It also became one of the most authoritarian, atheist, and murderous states in history. There was even an organization called the Communist International, aka Comintern. They openly advocated for a world government that would be run by the Soviet Union. It was not a secret. The West, in contrast, wasn't unified under one state like the Soviet Union was. They embraced international socialism under their own terms. After the Second World War, Western countries began to equate nationalism with racism. Resistance to open borders and uncontrolled immigration began to be equated with xenophobia. The West established the League of Nations right after the First World War, which was the first worldwide intergovernmental organization. Later on, they established several other intergovernmental organizations, such as the International Criminal Court, World Trade Organization, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, and so on. It's easy to see what they are setting up. They are literally establishing the New World Order in the open. The building blocks for a one-world government are being set up piece by piece as individual organizations. Both the West and the Soviet Union tried to achieve many of the same goals, but under different terms and conditions. Not everything is going to be known. As it is said, history is written by the victors. Secret meetings and whatever is discussed in them are rarely ever going to be made known to the public. It's more important to look at world events from a teleological point of view. For example, the West created NATO in 1949, which is an intergovernmental military alliance between dozens of countries. It was created in response to the Soviet Union, which was one of the two superpowers left after the Second World War. The other one was the USA, the leading Western state. When the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, NATO wasn't abolished, so it was not specifically created to oppose the Soviet Union. Coincidentally, war broke out in Yugoslavia right after the collapse of the Soviet Union. Just when the Soviet Union was unable to come to the aid of its ally Serbia, the collapse of Yugoslavia began, and it was used as an excuse to keep NATO. NATO is essentially the precursor to the upcoming world army. The Bible speaks of this and tells us where all of this will end. In Revelation chapter 13, the Bible says that a world government will be established. This government will have two rulers before God will intervene and destroy it. None other than Satan is behind the world government. That's not surprising, considering that Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, that Satan is the god of this world. So in addition to being able to exert religious power, Satan also wants to have a world government in place to exert political power. So it's also not a surprise that almost all leftists are atheists and that occultists and atheists are the biggest supporters of a world government. Confront a leftist with the idea of a world government and all associated facts, and the leftists will eventually argue that the world government is not a bad idea. They already support big government, so why not the biggest possible government? There are also fake religions, like the Baha'i Faith and Mormonism, that are in support of a world government. It's not a secret. David Rockefeller wrote in his book, Memoirs, start quote, "Some even believe we are part of a secret cabal, working against the best interests of the United States, characterizing my family and me as internationalists, and of conspiring with others around the world to build a more integrated global political and economic structure, one world, if you will. If that's the charge, I stand guilty, and I'm proud of it." End quote. Occultists have been openly proclaiming the beginning of a new era that will begin a new world order, such as the Age of Aquarius, New Age, Eon of Horus, and so on. Those who have eyes to see will see it, and those who have ears to hear will hear it. It's an economic, political, and occult movement against God, His work, and His people. It's spiritual warfare. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 says that our wrestling is not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the world's rulers of the darkness of this age, and against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places.